circular motion in a magnetic field.
The real business of accelerating the hydrogen ions takes place inside the cyclotron. In this lesson, we'll use the principles of Newton's laws and circular motion in a magnetic field to calculate the cyclotron frequency, which is the most important characteristic of a cyclotron.
As the ions enter into the cyclotron horizontally, the vertical magnetic field causes a force at right angles to both the field and the ion's velocity. However, the ions are still not traveling at the velocity we require. In order to accelerate them, their kinetic energy must increase. To do this, the cyclotron is separated into two D-shaped sections, a gap with a 186,000 volt potential difference runs down the middle of these Ds along the cyclotron's diameter. As the ion bunch crosses this gap, it is accelerated by an electric field. To continuously increase their kinetic energy, the electric field polarity switches each time the ions approach the gap, boosting their velocity and causing them to trace a spiral path outward. The electric field polarity switches millions of times per second. Called the cyclotron frequency, it's the cyclotron's most important characteristic.
Now let's use the principles of Newton's laws and circular motion in the magnetic field to calculate the cyclotron frequency.
Let's begin by calculating the radius and period of the ion's orbit after it enters the cyclotron. We'll need the strength of the cyclotron's magnetic field and the ion's entrance velocity. The force is a result of the cyclotron magnetic field, and the acceleration is centripetal due to circular motion. Rearranging the formulas, we can solve for the orbital radius. Substituting in the known values for the ion's mass, velocity, and charge, and the value of the magnetic field, we can determine the orbital radius. From this radius, we can calculate the time it takes the ions to complete an orbit by taking the circumference of the circle and dividing it by the ion's velocity. Let's substitute in the radius and velocity to determine the results. Known as the orbital period, this works out to be approximately 220 billionths of a second.
Now let's calculate the new energy and velocity of the ions after they cross the cyclotron gap once again.
Let's begin by calculating the initial kinetic energy before it crosses the gap. Substituting in the known values for the ion's mass and velocity, we get our result. Now let's add the potential energy from a 186,000 volt potential difference across the gap. Plugging in the known value of the ion's charge and the potential difference, we determine our result. Adding the two values together, we get the final kinetic energy, which is 7.78 times 10 to the minus 14 joules, or 486,000 electron volts, which is a unit of measurement preferred by TRIUMF scientists. The new velocity of the ions can be found from this new kinetic energy. Let's determine the value by rearranging the formula and substituting in the known values for the ion's mass and the new velocity. Now let's calculate the new radius and orbital period. Let's first calculate the radius by substituting in the known values for the ion's mass, its new velocity, its charge, and the cyclotron magnetic field. Now using the new radius and the new velocity, let's calculate the new orbital period. Here are the answers. Notice that the radius is larger, however, the orbital period is exactly the same. This is because, while the ions are traveling in a larger circle, their velocity has increased. They balance out exactly, so their orbital period doesn't change.
There is another way to look at this, and instead of using numbers, let's begin by using only the symbols.
The speed of the ion is related to the circumference and the orbital period. While the magnetic force is equal to the ion mass times its centripetal acceleration. By rearranging the formula, we see that the orbital period depends only on the ion mass and the cyclotron's magnetic field, and not on the velocity. This is known as the cyclotron principle. The frequency is the inverse of the orbital period, so this formula tells us that the orbital frequency is also constant, and this is known as the cyclotron frequency.
So let's calculate the cyclotron frequency using data obtained from TRIUMF. The table shows the proton velocities extracted at different radii within the TRIUMF cyclotron.
From the previous calculation, let's use the relationship between the ion's velocity and the orbital period. We know that the frequency is the inverse of the orbital period. So, plotting the proton velocity versus the extraction radius will give a straight line with slope proportional to the cyclotron frequency.
Why don't you try it out and see how close you are to the cyclotron frequency used at TRIUMF? The data and some additional help can be found in the workbook.